One Piece chapter 1000. Now, before we go on ahead and talk about this chapter, let's talk about how amazing this is. The fact that Oda has consistently wrote One Piece for 1000 weeks, it just shows you the dedication and care that he has for the series. And honestly, the fact that we're around to enjoy the series as it goes on, having all sorts of different discussions and tons of different theories born from every chapter, it's honestly just an amazing experience every week. The anticipation for reading a chapter has been the highest it's ever been. And again, congrats to Oda for creating this amazing piece of literature for people to enjoy. And of course, we are all expecting and hoping for the best as the series progresses. One Piece is reaching its climax, and I think we should all enjoy the ride, because once it's over, it's over. So might as well enjoy it right now. But back to One Piece chapter 1000. It's honestly kind of weird saying that, because there's not that many series that has this amount of chapters, and the fact that we're in the four digits now is insane. We're going into a new territory of chapters. But talking about this chapter, granted, we did have a lot of hype for this chapter in terms of what was going to be revealed, a lot of speculation as to what was going to happen, such as a potential Rocks flashback or the reveal of the Will of D. Now, even though we didn't get that in this chapter definitely delivered. This was amazing because we are seeing a lot of the things that we wanted come to fruition, and actually seeing it in the chapter is a different experience than actually talking about it. But let's start from the beginning. Now, the chapter starts off with Luffy's side of things, in which he is literally at the stairs to go up to the final stage, in which we come to learn that some of the musketeers helped Luffy create this path so that he could make it up there. And we get a little dialogue between Luffy and Shishilian, in which Luffy actually remembered who he was, because in cases like this, Luffy tends to forget a lot of people, especially people that he's met before. I mean, Luffy even forgot about Marco after a certain point, right? But I feel like at this point in time, especially given everything that's happened and since Zo, and seeing the struggle that the Minx went through, I think the tone was very clear, in which Luffy understood that this was real. And of course, their actions in Zo had a really profound effect on him and stuck with him, as well as the individuals involved with it, in which he tells Shishilian that he hasn't forgotten about how they gave their lives to Raizo. This was a really cool part of the chapter, and it goes to show you the emotions involved in this battle. They've been waiting 20 years for this to take place. Now is the time for it to happen. We then move on to Marco and Zoro's side of things, in which Marco is making his way to the roof and is then attacked by Queen and King. But again, given the nature of Marco's ability, which literally makes him almost invincible, even King and Queen aren't able to stop Marco. Marco proceeds to hold both of them off, which created a path for Zoro to make it to the roof. And it's really fun seeing the dynamic between two right-hand men, Marco being from the old era, being the right-hand man of Whitebeard, and Zoro being from the newer era, being the right-hand man of Luffy. It's almost like Marco knew that he had to help Luffy get up there, as Zoro has a role to play in all of this, as well as being from the new era. And it even goes back to a quote that he said in the previous chapter, in which he thinks that the Beast Pirates are underestimating the new era, and so he has a lot of faith in Luffy and the others. But Zoro interacting with Marco was definitely a cool addition, for as short as it was, right? Now, moving on to Yamato and Momo. Yamato tells Momo about some of the things that she learned from Odin's journal, and given the fact that she never thought that she was going to meet Momo, she was going to keep it. But since they met, she tells him that she might as well pass it on to Momo, as that is something that belongs to his father. And this is very interesting, because we know that the ability to write on the poneglyph wasn't passed down from Odin to Momo, because Odin died before he could teach Momonosuke. But is there a possibility that Momo might find the answers in Odin's notebook, in which it helps him obtain the ability to write on the poneglyphs? Now, not necessarily that it gives him direct answers, but more so steps on what he needs to do in order to learn it. I think that could be something that the notebook would provide for him, and I wouldn't be surprised if Odin left something there specifically for Momo to see. But this is really great for Momo, just because Momo was only a kid when Odin passed away, and he didn't really get to see what type of person his dad was. Obviously, he knew that his dad was a Chad, pretty much, right? So Momo reading Odin's journal is definitely something that can add to his character, as Odin is a huge part as to why Momo wants to become someone capable, someone that is able to achieve things like Odin. And I think we're going to see that as the story progresses, and we've always known that Momo was important. I feel like there's been a lot of key elements that is going to make Momo play a very essential role in the future. Him having the voice of all things and having the ability to control Zunisha makes this more evident. We also come to see a flashback between Ace and Yamato, in which they are talking about Luffy and how Luffy had this dream that Ace and Sabo initially laughed about, but after seeing his conviction, they started to truly believe in him, to the point that it's become something that they would never laugh at or even allow other people to laugh at. We also come to find out that this is a term that Roger also used to say, which we actually didn't know about beforehand. We always thought that this phrase was sort of unique to Luffy, but apparently Roger used to say the same thing. Again, we're seeing the parallels become more evident between Roger and Luffy, if it wasn't already. And again, it's very interesting because Yamato describes the chain of events that are happening in Wano and a sense of destiny taking its course, in which we are seeing how Luffy is interconnected to all these different individuals and how everything is coming together to create something big. And we've always known that prophecy is a thing in One Piece in which some things are just destined to happen. We got a lot of that in the Odin flashback, in which we know that Joy Boy is supposed to reappear 20 years in the future, as he will be the individual to bring about a new dawn. And that is definitely pointing towards Luffy here. And Yamato also talks about the future that Odin envisioned, in which it was said that in about 20 years, the next generation of pirates who will lead the next era will arrive in the new world, and if I were to die, they are the ones who will defeat Kaido. And again, this scene goes hand in hand with Yamato's words, in which we come to see the pirates of the new era standing against those of the old. And this panel here is just insanely hype. We have Kid, we have Killer, we have Law, we have Luffy and Zoro standing in front of these calamities, ready to battle, and there is no sense of fear. The worst generation are ready to make a name for themselves, and it's definitely happening. All of the supernovas are looking really badass right now. And of course, Luffy's arrival comes last, in which he makes his grand entry. And the funny thing is that even though Big Mom and Kaido were in front of him, they weren't his point of concern. What he was really worried about was Kinemon injured behind them, in which he literally strolls between Big Mom and Kaido to hold Kinemon. That was epic. This is so reminiscent of Hunter x Hunter, and you guys probably know what scene I'm talking about here. But Luffy really showed how raw of an MC he is in this chapter. You can definitely see the growth on Luffy's part, where he's capable of showing no signs of stress in front of the individuals that have dealt with him in the past. Luffy is a different beast going into this, especially given the suffering that Kaido put other people through. The build up with the Minks and Wano, everything has just come to a boiling point, and I don't think we're ready, guys. I do not think we're ready for this, but I know it's gonna be epic. And we also get to see a new attack from Luffy here, in which Kaido tried to hit Luffy, but Luffy counters it with a Gear Third Punch, which devastates Kaido. And from what it looks like, it has the effects of a Red Hawk, so Luffy is now capable of using fire properties on Gear 3rd. And not only that, there is a possibility that maybe he's developed a gear surrounding Red Hawk now. We also know that the attack actually hurt Kaido, because we can see that he took damage, so Luffy right now is definitely flexing on that Ryo right now. And of course, Luffy reiterates the words that speaks to his soul: I will become the king of pirates. Epic chapter. And again, guys, the build-up was just amazing. This chapter was definitely, Oda definitely delivered for One Piece chapter 1000. This was great. So again, I cannot wait to see more with these many charismatic characters on one battlefield. The hype levels are just crazy right now. And it's funny because the fight hasn't even started yet, guys. This is just the beginning. So this is just too much right now. I will say that it's definitely a good time to be a One Piece fan right now, because we are eating. But again, give me your thoughts on this chapter, guys. This chapter was huge. Great chapter. Comment down below what you guys think. I would appreciate it if you guys dropped a like on this video. Follow me on Twitter at FerrohSpace, and subscribe for more One Piece content, guys. It is Ferro, and I will see you folks later. Peace.